We had a pretty specific idea about this, how these background parts would work and the sort of swing band rhythmic approach and how we wanted it phrased and so on. This when I was singing a little like Jerry Lewis, remember that?
Yeah.
What can you do?
That was a very fertile period for you.
Yeah. I'm gonna take these out of solo now. Well,
Deacon Blues is a great track. They've always had an affection for these kind of faded hipsters, but I think Deacon Blues takes that affection to an almost philosophical level. It's become it brings a nobility to that kind of faded hipster attitude, which I think has very deep roots in their own personalities. You know, they were both young kids, most influenced really by bohemian beatnik attitudes of the late 50s and early 60s. Throw a key.
Here's our electric guitar over here, Larry Carlton.
Tasty.
Yeah. Larry played live on a lot of these dates, and he had he was very good on rhythm dates at really being a core pulse for tunes and holding them from moving around too much rhythmically. And he had usually done the charts on tunes that he was playing on.
I think of myself as the person that they wanted to be the liaison between themselves and the studio musicians. They would give me their demo tape, and it had those wonderful piano parts on it, and many of the bass parts were on there also. And I would be the person that would take those notes off of the tape, fill in the blanks where they weren't sure of what they wanted to be played, and then I would take that chart to the session, and I would be the person who was familiar with the song out in the studio with the studio musicians. So if Donald or Walter would say, Larry, when we go to the bridge at the such and such, I would be able to tell the musicians, that's bar 19, B flat 7th with a raised 9.
Sort of hear the bass, it's just sort of floating along. You know, I was overdubbing over an existing track. Usually the bass player has to work a little harder to drive the track, but it was already there, and for some reason I kind of like the idea just floating along here in the verse. And then here it goes to sort of a more conventional.
Now later we added
beat, rhythmic beat.
We added
acoustic guitar. Dean Parks?
Yeah.
It's nice.
One interesting thing about Donald and Walter is that perfection is not what they're after. They're after something that you want to listen to over and over again. So we would work then past the perfection point until it became natural, until it sounded almost improvised in a way. So it was like a two-step process. One was to get to perfection, and then the other is to get beyond it and to loosen it up a little bit so that it didn't have to be the perfect, squeaky clean goal. It is quite an amalgamation, that's for sure. And it's interesting to note that it can be a hit.
Deacon Blues is about as close to autobiography as our tunes get. You know, we were both kids who grew up in the suburbs. We both felt, you know, fairly alienated. But like a lot of kids in the 50s, we were looking for some kind of alternative culture, some kind of escape, really, from where we found ourselves. And I think Deacon Blues is a nice kind of example of that.
Protagonist is not a musician. He just sort of imagines that that would be one of the mythic forms of loserdom to which he might aspire. And, you know, who's to say that he's not right? A thing like that. There's a synthesizer pad on here somewhere.
Yeah, this
thing
here.
What the hell is that all about?
Let's see.
Go roll back a second, Rog.
There it is.
It's got department store. That's what I'm thinking of. It's like that bing, bing here.
Okay. It's like, you know, what's the big toy store on 59th Street?
F.A.O. Schwartz.
F.A.O. Schwartz. It's like, you know, they play that same song over and over with those kinds of sounds in them.
Yeah.
Kids like it because it's like such primary, a Christmassy.
It's the equivalent of an audio equivalent of a primary color kind of thing, you know?
It's kind of a pheromone for tots. You bring them in. And
we put that in. Why did we put that in there?
Because, you know why?
To fatten
I
up
think
the
maybe
horns?
The flute, there was a flute part on the top, and we needed trumpets that didn't cut.
We wanted to
cover
it. So
I wanted to put a little high end on
to
the.
To brighten and clarify.
Right, so then here's his without the synthesizer. It goes like this. Or maybe we couldn't find a flute player or something. Okay, now let's play it again, and I'll put this guy in here. Sort of a flute simulation, really, wouldn't you say?
Or it's marked here as a celeste. So maybe we were thinking of it for some reason as though it were like a bells or something going along with that thing. Although it doesn't sound the least bit like a celeste.
I was always amazed that they pretty much heard in their heads what it was going to be like completed. So they knew right away when you get a bunch of musicians together and they're cutting the tracks and Donald Walter would be sitting in the control room going, no, this is not it. It's not going to happen. So maybe we'll try this other tune with these guys. Then they get another band in to try the tunes that didn't work out. And all through the project, they would know, nope, that's not it. That's not working. This is what I want. And it was amazing that when the thing got done, finally I could see what everything was going to be like. But they knew from the very beginning.
I play just what I feel.
Beautiful.
A basic gospel response type of thing. You put in the lead, and we'll see. Part of the reason I was driven towards jazz was when the radio stopped playing Chuck Berry and Little Richard, and this is when I was quite young, but I still noticed that something was wrong with the music after a while when they started playing white singers